this step, this is like out of nowhere. When I was a student, this step confused me a lot. But I'm going to show you guys how to do this kind of things without the minimum. Today, I want to talk about one step that caused so many confusions when we are proving a limit by using the epsilon-delta definition. I'm not talking about the definition itself because I know this right here is confusing already. I'm talking about just that one step, which happens quite a lot, especially when we are dealing with a nonlinear function. So, what is it? Let's take a look at this example. Let's prove the limit as x approaching 2 of x squared is equal to 4. So you know the four usual steps. Given, choose, suppose, check. We start with given epsilon greater than 0. We have to choose the delta, but we don't know what it is yet, so I'm going to leave it blank. And then we are going to suppose that the distance between x and 2 is in between of 0 and delta, and the distance we use absolute value. And make sure you have less than right here. At the end, we have to make sure the distance between the function and the limit, which is the absolute value, and just subtract x squared with 4. We have to make sure that this is less than epsilon. Okay, so this right here is the usual blueprint, and of course from here to here is just factoring. Now, absolute value of x minus 2, we have this right here. We can say that is less than delta. That is fine. But what do we do with this though? Absolute value of x plus 2. This is what we usually do, and this is what I've been telling you guys to do as well. Nice and easy. Right here, I'll just tell you guys, if you are stuck with something like this, you just go here and then just put down minimum and then a brace and then use 1. Why though? Well, firstly, 1 is easy. Could you have put 2 or 1 half? Yes and yes. Could you put 17? Yes, but just don't do that. You can put any number that you want. Why though? Well, once we have this number right here, we are allowed to come here and then look at this inequality as absolute value of x minus 2 is less than whatever you put it right here, which you put it 1, then you just do 1. If you put down 1 half here, then you put down 1 half here, and you can continue. It's definitely easier when you have an actual number right here to work with. But today's question is it possible for us to do the epsilon delta definition proof without this step? And of course, yes for this example, but not yes all the time. Let's finish this right here first, okay? So, once we have this thing right here, remember we have to get a bound for the absolute value of x plus 2. So, open the absolute value, that means the inside. X minus 2 has to be in between of negative 1 and positive 1. Now, I'm trying to get to x plus 2. This is x minus 2, it's okay. Let's just add 4 to all three sides. So you can see the middle is x plus 2, and that will be in between of 3 and 5. That's nice. And you can see that x plus 2 is in between of 3 and 5. You can just think about this is definitely bigger than negative 5. I'm going to just say this concludes that, what implies that absolute value of x plus 2 has to be less than 5, right? Because you can say that's greater than negative 5 and then just bound it. Now this is nice because you can now come here and say this thing is less than 5. We have the less than already, so we just have to multiply this by 5. And remember at the end, we have to get an epsilon only, right here. So you can just imagine this is equal to epsilon and divide both sides by 5. Delta has to be epsilon over 5, and you put it here. Close that. And once you have this, you can come here and replace the delta with epsilon over 5. Now, here's a small detail. Because we said delta is the minimum of this or that, right here you should put less than or equal to, right? Because it's the minimum. And once you have this, check this out. 5 and 5 cancel. This is definitely just equal to epsilon. Done. Very nice, huh? Now, here's the deal. Why do we do this and how do we know to do this? Well, as I said earlier, we did that because we can make this much easier, right? But when you first see this, you're not going to accept it. It's like this step, I will agree with you that this is like out of nowhere. When I was a student, this step confused me a lot as well. But I will tell you this though. This is like the nature of writing a math proof. Sometimes, as long as the proof works, then it works. This step here definitely can make this proof work. So just follow along, it works. If you write something down like this, it's perfect. But the main part today is that I'm going to show you guys how to do this kind of things without the minimum of one, like this one right here. So let's have a look. So firstly, these steps right here are still the same. The main part is that we have to figure out how to handle absolute value of x plus 2. So here are some notes. Note number one, absolute value of x plus 2. Notice that we have two things set of the absolute value, which is a good thing because we can use the triangle inequality. This is less than or equal to absolute value of the first plus absolute value of the second. And of course, that's the same as just a regular 2. But now, do not replace absolute value of x plus 2 with absolute value of x and then plus 2. It's not going to be helpful because right here at this step, you should not see any x. Okay? Because when you're writing proofs, you can only write down what you have. Remember, right here we have epsilon being given to be greater than 0, and later on, the delta has to be an expression in terms of epsilon. No x right here allowed. So, what do we do next though? Well, don't worry. We still have this right here that we can use, right? But we have to utilize it like that. Have a look. The key right here is that we have absolute value of x. I had to think about how to handle it. Check this out. Absolute value of x, right here, I really want to have an x minus 2 inside of the absolute value. Let's make that happen. Subtract 2 right here. But don't worry, I'm not going to change anything as long as I add a 2 after that. Very nice, huh? And this is a very common step when you do real analysis proof. Yeah, it's like, oh wow, how do you know to do it? But the idea, the hint is that you have to look back to see what you are working with. This is the expression that you have, so you really want to have this. Now, again, we have two things inside of absolute value adding. Why? This is the first, this is the second. So what can we do? Triangle inequality, yes. Once again, we can say this is less than or equal to absolute value of the first plus absolute value of the second. Now, what's this? We know this, that. That is less than delta, so we can come here and say that's less than delta, and absolute value of 2 is once again just a 2. So we can see that absolute value of x is less than delta plus 2. Now, combining 1 and 2 together, we will have absolute value of x plus 2, which from 1 we know that is less than or equal to absolute value of x plus 2. And then from 2 right here, we can see that this is just all absolute value of x right here. Absolute value of x is less than delta plus 2. So we can say this is less than, that is part, delta plus 2. And we still have this plus 2 after that. So really, absolute value of x plus 2 is going to be less than, this is equal to delta plus 4. Now we can go ahead and put this for that, delta plus 4, no more x. Okay, how do we proceed? Well, this is similar to what we did earlier. Remember, at the very end, we want to end up with just an epsilon, right? So we have to make this equal to epsilon and then solve for delta. Now, this is why we have the minimum one step. Why? Because it's easier to work with actual numbers. Right here, this is still doable when you set it equal epsilon and then solve for delta because this is just going to be a regular quadratic. But imagine if you have a crazy cubic or like a crazier function, it's not going to be so easy to solve for delta. Well, I know you can, well, no, don't do anything else. I'm just going to finish this right here for you guys. So like I said, we are going to make delta times delta plus 4 equal epsilon. So this is the same as delta squared plus 4 delta. It's equal to epsilon. And I'm going to complete the square. We have a 1 right here already. Take half of this coefficient, which will be 2. Square that, which is 4. Add 4 to both sides. This is the perfect square. delta plus 2 squared is equal to epsilon plus 4. Take the square root to both sides, plus minus, but remember, epsilon and delta, they both have to be greater than 0, so I'm not going to consider the negative. Just take the positive. Delta plus 2 is equal to square root of epsilon plus 4. Subtract 2 to both sides. Now, ladies and gentlemen, this is an expression of delta, and as you can see, that is in terms of epsilon. We are going to come back to here. Square root of epsilon plus 4 and then minus 2. That is the delta. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we have all this. Once we reach this here, delta is this, so we can say that is equal to 2 times, and then here we have that plus 4. And of course, this right here is just plus 2. Have a look. This is actually a difference of two square formula, right? We have a minus b times a plus b. So the result is a squared minus b squared. That will give us this thing squared, which is just epsilon plus 4, and then minus the second thing squared, which is 4. Have a look. 4 and minus 4 cancel, and once again, we end up with just epsilon. Absolute value of x squared minus 4 is less than epsilon. So you know that this proof is once again done. This is the best delta you can come up with for this proof. What do I mean by that though? Well, I'm going to tell you guys that right now.